GRE. The GRE exam is written and administered by the Educational Testing Service, or ETS, the same people who gave you the SAT. It's one of several key factors in determining graduate school admissions. The others are your undergraduate GPA, your work experience, if any, and if it's relevant to the type of graduate program you're applying to, your teacher recommendations, and your application essay. As you can see from this list, your GRE scores are among the few factors that you have any direct control over right now, along with your application essay, of course. Your undergraduate GPA and your work experience are already in the past, and you don't have any direct control over changing those right now. And your teacher recommendations, of course, are up to the professors whom you ask to write them. So it certainly makes sense to try to maximize your GRE score in order to improve your chances of getting into the graduate program of your choice. The GRE exam is designed to help universities predict your academic performance in year one of graduate school. This is why universities use the GRE exam. They feel that it helps to round out their picture of you as a potential graduate student by helping them figure out how well you're likely to do during year one of your graduate school performance. The GRE exam tests three different skill areas: analytical writing, or writing, verbal reasoning, or the use and understanding of words, and quantitative reasoning, which is about mathematical skills. The verbal and quantitative reasoning parts of the GRE exam are based strictly on multiple choice or numeric entry questions. In other words, these are all short answer questions, while the analytical writing part of the exam actually requires you to write two essays, and we'll be giving you much more information about all this later. You'll be given three scores on the GRE corresponding to those three skill areas. On analytical writing, you'll receive a score ranging between 0 and 6, with the scores varying at half-point increments. In other words, there are scores like 2, 2.5, 3, 3.5, and so on. An average score on the analytical writing test is likely to be somewhere between 4 and 4.5. On the verbal reasoning portion of the exam, you'll receive a score ranging between 130 and 170, with the scores varying at 1-point increments. So typical scores might be 150, 151, 152, and so on. An average score is likely to be somewhere around 150. And on quantitative reasoning, the same score scale is used. That is, a score ranging between 130 and 170, varying at 1-point increments. And again, an average score is likely to be somewhere around 150. In addition to the GRE general test, you may also have to take a GRE subject test when you apply to graduate school. These GRE subject tests are currently offered in several subject areas, including biochemistry with cell and molecular biology, biology, chemistry, computer science, literature and English, mathematics, physics, and psychology. The university department that you're applying to can offer you guidance as to whether or not a subject test is necessary. Now, there are two different ways to take the GRE general test. The test is offered in a computer-based format year-round at test centers in the United States, Canada, and many other countries. If you live in an area where the computer-based test is not available, you can take the GRE on specified dates at paper-based test centers. Most students, however, will take the computer-based test, as ETS has gone out of their way to make the computer-based test available in most parts of the world. And the computer-based test will be our primary focus throughout this program. You can register for the exam online, by phone, or by mail. You'll need a credit card to pay fees if you register online or by phone. The GRE subject tests are all paper-based, and you register for these online or by mail. Detailed information on all registration procedures is available at your school or online at www.ets.org. Also available at the same ETS website is the official test prep software for the GRE general test. This program simulates the testing interface of the real computer-based GRE. It also contains sample test questions with answers and explanations, a full practice test, and advice on test-taking strategies. In addition to this software, the ETS website contains a treasure trove of other resources that can help you boost your score on the GRE. So be sure to gather and use all of the materials that ETS makes available regarding the GRE. These will complement the information and techniques you'll learn from this program. So if you combine what you'll be learning from me in the next few hours with the materials that are available from ETS on the internet, you'll find you'll have a very complete preparation program that can help you score your personal best on the GRE. Many people wonder whether they should take the GRE exam more than once. Let's take a moment to discuss the strategy for this. You can take the GRE more than once, and some students should do so. In particular, if your scores the first time you take the test are low, you should consider retaking the exam. However, the way in which schools interpret multiple GRE scores varies. Some universities will average all your scores, some will use the highest score, and some will use only the most recent score. You may want to ask the admissions offices of the universities to which you're applying how they work with multiple GRE tests. They should have a standard policy that they use with all applicants. And this policy may help you decide whether or not it's worthwhile to take the exam more than once. Notice that when you take the exam two or more times, all your scores will be reported to the schools to which you're applying. And with the universities where the average score is used, you should realize that your overall performance will be dragged down just a bit by the lower scores that you accumulate. So if you have one low score and one high score, you won't get the full benefit of the higher score at a university which averages scores. Therefore, it's good strategy for all students to try to practice and prepare before they take the GRE for the first time, so you'll have the maximum possible chance of earning your highest personal score the first time you take the GRE. Not only will you save the time, energy, and money that's required to take the exam a second or a third time, but in addition, you'll make sure that you'll get the benefit of complete preparation and the highest possible score that you can earn, as opposed to having to suffer a little bit from the averaging of two or more scores, some of which may be good and some not so good. So do your best the first time you take the exam, and then hopefully taking it a second or third time won't even be a necessary consideration. Note that you can't take the GRE more than once in any 60-day period, and you can't take it more than 5 times in a 12-month period. So plan in advance for your application process to the graduate schools of your choice, and make sure you sign up to take the GRE exam early enough so that if necessary, you can take it a second time during the admissions process. A word about procedures to expect when you take the computer-based GRE. You can't bring anything into the test center other than your personal ID. No calculators, phones, PDAs, personal digital assistants, cameras, or other electronic devices can be brought into the test centers. You also can't bring any food or drink. The test center proctors will provide you with scratch paper for making notes, and you're not allowed to take this scratch paper from the room. You can only use it while you're taking the test, and then it will be discarded. If you do take the paper-based test, including any of the subject tests, you should bring several sharpened No. 2 pencils, which you'll need to fill in the answer blanks. But if you take the computer-based test, don't bring pens or pencils. You won't be needing them. You'll be provided a tool to work on the scratch paper with. Now let's talk about what to expect on the computer-based GRE. The computer-based exam is divided into 6 test sections. The test normally begins with the analytical writing section. This section includes 2 parts, each of which requires you to write an essay. One part is called the Analyze and Issue task. The other is called the Analyze and Argument task. You'll have 30 minutes for each task, or a total of 1 hour for this first section of the exam. This is followed by 5 more sections. 2 sections are devoted to verbal reasoning. Each of these sections includes around 20 questions to be answered in 30 minutes. 2 sections are devoted to quantitative reasoning, each containing about 20 questions to be answered in 35 minutes. The order of these 4 sections will vary from one test to another. So you could have verbal followed by quantitative, quantitative followed by verbal, or have them in any order. This leaves one more section, either an experimental section or a research section. It may be unidentified and seem like a typical verbal or quantitative reasoning section. This would describe an experimental section. Or it may be identified and feature some non-standard question types, and this would characterize a research section. An experimental section is typically used to test out questions for possible use on the GRE in the future. These are questions that have been written by the people at ETS and which they want to test to see whether they're too hard, too easy, or simply don't make clear sense to the test takers. However, these experimental sections are not labeled as such, and they can appear anywhere in the test sequence after the analytical writing section. An experimental section will seem just like any other verbal or quantitative reasoning section. So you can't always be completely sure whether a given verbal or quantitative reasoning section is experimental. The experimental section could come second, fourth, fifth, or anywhere else in the section sequence. That means you just need to do your best on all these sections of the exam. That said, if you encounter a verbal or a quantitative reasoning question type that is completely unfamiliar and different from anything that you learn about in this program, it's probably safe to assume that that test section is experimental. From time to time, ETS does dream up new types of questions which they're considering using on future exams. And before using them for real, they use them in an experimental section to see what kind of results they get. So if you encounter some weird question type, chances are good they are experimenting with it. Go ahead and work the questions and, of course, do your best to answer them correctly. But you don't need to worry about them or to freak out because of the oddity of the question type. In this program, we'll prepare you for all the question types that are used for real on the GRE. If you encounter anything that's out of the ordinary or that doesn't match up with what you learned in this program, it's experimental and almost certainly won't count on your score. Research sections, on the other hand, are a little easier to handle. If you have a research section, it will be labeled as such, and it will always appear last in the test sequence. That is, it will be the 6th of the 6 sections. ETS uses research sections from time to time to analyze relationships and detect trends among different test questions, different scores, and different population groups. They are used exactly as they're labeled for research by the test makers at ETS. In any case, the good news about experimental and research sections is that neither counts toward your score. So if you have a research section, again, do your best on it, but don't worry particularly about whether you've done well or not. And if you have a section that appears weird, it's probably experimental, and again, won't count toward your score. Now, as we said, the analytical writing section contains prompts for writing 2 different essays, the analyze and issue task and the analyze and argument task. In a little while in this program, we'll go into the analytical writing section in quite a bit of detail and give you tools and techniques for doing your best on these 2 essays. The verbal reasoning sections on the GRE contain 4 main question types. There are 2 types of reading comprehension questions, multiple choice questions and select in passage questions. There are text completion questions and sentence equivalence questions. Now, within a verbal reasoning section, these 4 types of questions will probably bounce around from one type to another. So, for example, the section might begin with 2 reading comprehension questions, which might be followed by 4 text completions, followed by 3 sentence equivalence items, and so on. The reading comprehension passages will include both short and long reading passages, each accompanied by some questions on the contents, structure, and style of the passage. You can never predict exactly what sequence the question types in a verbal reasoning section will appear, and so simply be prepared to handle any question type in any sequence that the test makers choose to use for your particular exam. The quantitative reasoning sections on the GRE contain three main question types: multiple choice questions, numeric entry questions, and quantitative comparison questions. As with the verbal reasoning sections, the quantitative reasoning sections will likely skip among question types. For example, you might have a section that begins with 6 quantitative comparisons, followed by 4 multiple choice items, followed by a numeric entry question, then 5 more multiple choice questions, and so on. Again, the exact sequence is difficult to predict. This program will include a detailed analysis of all 3 quantitative reasoning question types, as well as all of the verbal reasoning question types. We'll provide you with special test-taking strategies that will help you score your best, and we'll review all the math skills you'll need for the quantitative sections of the GRE. So you'll end this program with techniques for earning your highest possible score on all of the question types, including the verbal and quantitative reasoning sections, as well as the analytical writing section. Now, all of the questions will appear on the computer screen in the cubicle to which you're assigned at the test center, and all your work will be done on the computer. For the quantitative reasoning sections, an on-screen calculator will be provided. This is why you're not permitted to bring your own calculator. You'll be given one on the computer which you can use for all your calculations. When you're working on a multiple choice question with only one correct answer, you'll use the computer mouse to click on the oval that designates your desired answer choice. If you want to change your answer, simply click on a different one. For multiple choice questions with multiple answers, you'll use the computer mouse to click on each box that designates the desired answer choice, and click on any selected box again to deselect it. Scratch paper and a pencil will be provided for making notes and for making any kind of calculations that you want to do on paper for some reason, drawing a diagram for a geometry question, for example. But of course, whatever you write on the scratch paper will not affect your score. You'll only get credit for the answers that you select and enter on the computer. Now, when you're working on the analytical writing assignments, for which you need to write 2 separate essays, you'll type your words on the computer screen, much as you do when you use a word processing program to write a paper for school or work. Again, you can use scratch paper to make notes and to outline your essay, and we'll be providing you with some strategies for doing just that to the greatest effect to improve your essay. But those notes won't be read by anyone, and they won't play any role in the evaluation or the scoring of your writing. To earn a score on any given test section on the computerized GRE, you must answer a minimum number of questions. I wouldn't worry too much about this, though. Most students find they have plenty of time to get through the required number of questions. And in fact, most students find that they have enough time to get through all the questions in a given section within the minutes allotted. But you do need to keep working steadily without a lot of dawdling or daydreaming. You wouldn't want to find that you have just a couple of minutes left and a large number of questions left to answer in those last few minutes. So work steadily through the section so that you'll have plenty of time to review your work at the end. Now, you may have heard that the computerized version of the GRE is an adaptive exam, a new type of exam that computer technology makes possible. There's a lot of confusion among students about exactly what this means. It is true that the GRE is an adaptive exam, but it's important to understand exactly how this works. When the computerized GRE was first introduced, the exam was adaptive in a special sense. Students were not allowed to work on the questions in the order they preferred. Instead, you had to answer question 1 before you could see question 2. You had to finish question 2 before you could see question 3, and so on. And you couldn't go back to an earlier question during a particular section. Once you finished question one, you could never see it again. Now, this rule allowed the test makers to choose questions one at a time based on how well you were performing. In this sense, the computerized GRE was adaptive within sections. Now, this has changed. The computerized GRE that you take will not be adaptive in this way. On the computerized GRE now, you can tackle the questions within a given section in any order you prefer. So, for example, if you find question 11 in a particular section very tough, you can skip it and come back to it later. At the end of a complete section, if you want to go back to question 1 or question 5 or any other question and take another look at it to make sure you answered it correctly, you're perfectly able to do that. As a result, the computerized GRE is no longer adaptive on a question-by-question basis within sections. Instead, it seems that the GRE is now adaptive by section. For example, after you complete your first quantitative reasoning section, your second quantitative reasoning section will vary based on how well you did on the first one. So, if you scored high on your first quantitative section, your second section might be a little harder. If you scored low, you may get a section that's a little easier. And the difficulty levels of all your questions will be taken into account when your final score is calculated. This means, of course, that you want to do as well as possible throughout the exam. If you do well on your first quantitative or verbal section, you'll get slightly more difficult questions for the later section, but you'll also have the opportunity to earn a higher overall score. So do as well as possible on all the sections of the exam, because this will maximize your chances of earning the highest possible score, and therefore your chances of impressing the admissions officers at the university that you'd most like to attend. Now let's talk about test-taking strategies. Naturally, as with any test, you need to think about and prepare for the peculiar characteristics of the computer-based test in order to do well on it. Scoring high requires not just the skills being tested, writing skills, verbal skills, and math skills, but also test-taking skills. This program will help you learn and master those skills, and we'll start now with a set of basic strategies that apply throughout the computer-based GRE. First and foremost, practice, practice, practice with the official GRE test prep software, if, like most test takers, you plan on taking the computer-based GRE. Learn the interface inside and out. Become so familiar with the icons, the symbols, the tools, and the controls that using them becomes second nature. If you already use a computer for school or work, you'll find this relatively simple and a familiar process. It's much like learning to use any kind of software, whether it's word processing software, database software, or any other kind of software. You learn certain particular ways of using the computer, which becomes second nature. You should know how to enter and change your answers on the computer-based GRE, how to scroll through screens of text, how to navigate from one question to the next, how to access features like help, the test directions, and the calculator, and how to review your work within a section, and how to write and edit an essay within the software. The more comfortable you are with all of these techniques on the computer, the easier and more familiar you'll find it on the day of the test, and the less time and energy you'll need to expend on figuring out how to use the computer. You'll be able to concentrate simply on the questions themselves and on the thinking skills that are required to get them right. Also, especially if you aren't computer savvy, it's a good idea to practice with Windows software in general before test day. Become very familiar with the standard icons and controls that are used in Windows-based software. For example, the right arrow, which means forward and which indicates you're ready to move on to the next question, the left arrow, in case you need to go back to the previous question for some reason, the hourglass, which means the computer is thinking and you need to wait until it's ready, and the scroll bar, which is used with the mouse to move up and down through a reading passage. the more comfortable you are with the software and with all the controls that are used with the software, the easier and less stressful it will be on the day of the real exam, and the more you'll be able to focus strictly on the thinking skills that are required to do your best on the exam. 2. Spend 15 to 20 minutes on the tutorial. This is an instructional program that is presented to you at the start of the exam session when you sit down for the real GRE. The tutorial walks you through the various computer skills you need to handle the exam. You'll probably find it quite simple, and you might be tempted to think it's unnecessary and maybe to skip it altogether. But we suggest that you don't. It will help you to relax, to work through the tutorial before tackling the real questions. And it will also make it harder for you to make careless errors due to clicking in the wrong place. So invest the few minutes required to work your way through the tutorial, and it will help you feel that much more comfortable when the real exam begins. 3. Preview each section before beginning work. This means skimming through the whole test section and figuring out how long it is and where the hardest questions are. Use this information to budget your time. 4. Tackle the easier questions in the section first. Save the hardest ones for later. So if there's a particular topic you find most difficult, even if questions on that topic come first in the section, don't do them first. Start with question 6 if necessary, and save the hardest ones for later. This will enable you to rack up as many points on easy questions as possible and build up a head of steam before tackling the hardest questions, which may then be a little easier to do. 5. Don't get bogged down on difficult questions. Answer them quickly, then move on. You can always return to them later if you have time at the end of the section. So simply work your way through the questions at a deliberate pace. Try not to dawdle or spend too much time on any one question. If you end up spending 5 minutes on a question, for example, you may end up getting it right, but then you may find that you are pressed for time to answer the last few questions in the section, which could hurt your overall performance. So after you've spent a minute or two on a question, even if you're not 100% sure of the answer, put down your best estimate as to the answer and move on to the next question. If you have a few minutes extra at the end of the section, you can always come back and check it later. The important thing is not to get overly bogged down on one or two questions, but keep making steady progress. 6. Click on plausible answers one at a time as you come to them. As you work your way through an individual question, you'll see a number of answer choices laid out on the screen in front of you. As you go through those answer choices, click on any one that appears plausible. So perhaps the first answer might strike you as pretty good. That sounds like that could be right. In which case, click on it and highlight that particular answer choice. You may then find that the second answer is a little better, in which case, click on that one. The mark from the first answer will immediately disappear, and the second answer will then be highlighted. You may then find that the fourth or fifth answer is better still. Click on that one and you'll have the correct answer and you'll be ready to move on to the next question. In this way, you'll end up with the most plausible choice of all and you'll be ready to click on the right arrow to move ahead to the next item. This technique will not only save you precious seconds, but it will help to make sure that you've read and considered all of the answer choices before moving on to the next question. 7. Answer every question, even if you must guess at random. There is no guessing penalty on the GRE, so you won't lose any points for answering a question incorrectly. And you may get some of those random answers right, which will improve your score. 8. Click on the Help button to review full-length instructions for any section, question type, and so on, if needed. As you work your way through each test section, you'll find that brief, single-sentence versions of the directions are provided for each question type. You'll see that these will appear on each page of the computer test. These single-sentence versions of the directions will usually suffice. It will be clear to you through your practice exactly how to answer the questions. But if you find yourself momentarily confused, click on the Help button for a quick refresher, and the full-length directions will immediately appear. 9. Use scratch paper freely. In a traditional paper-based test, like the ones that you are probably used to from your college experience and perhaps from past standardized exams, many test takers like to use the margins of the test booklet for notes, to highlight particular parts of a reading passage, to do calculations, or to keep track of information that they might otherwise forget. Now, of course, you can't do this with the computer-based test since there is no test booklet. All of the questions appear on the computer screen. This is why the scratch paper has been provided. So feel free to use it in any way that you are comfortable with. You might want to number the scratch paper notations that you make on the page so that when you're working on question 6, your notes for question 6 are labeled as 6. And if you review the question later, you can find those particular notes easily. If you happen to use up all the scratch paper that you're provided with, just raise your hand and the test proctor will be happy to provide you with some additional pages of scratch paper. So don't worry about running out. 10. Mark tricky questions that you may want to review later. In the current version of the computer adaptive test on the GRE, you are allowed to go back and forth within a given section and review questions that you may have been uncertain about. So when you complete a particular question, if you feel uneasy about it, thinking, I think I might have gotten this one wrong, or I'm not sure that my reasoning on this one is completely correct, use the checkbox which is offered at the top of the screen in order to mark it for later review. This way, at the end of the section, you can go back to those particular questions that you've highlighted as being ones that you might want to reconsider. And often, this strategy will work very, very well. Because let's say question 4 is one that you consider tricky and that you marked with the checkbox. By the time you've finished the complete section and you have several minutes remaining before time runs out, and you go back to question 4, you may find that your unconscious mind has been thinking about question 4 while you work your way through the entire rest of the section. And you may well find that as soon as you look at question 4 again, you see it in a new way and immediately recognize, this is the strategy I should have used. And it becomes very clear what's the correct answer. So give yourself the opportunity to take advantage of this common habit of the human mind. Mark any question that you have any uncertainty about and come back to it at the end of the section. Chances are good you'll get a couple of extra questions right just by using that strategy. 11. Use any spare time at the end of the section to review your work. If you've worked through the questions at a steady pace, you'll probably find that you'll have several minutes available at the end of the section to review your work. You don't have to review every question. Instead, you can go to the review screen, which lists all the questions in the section by number. The review screen will also tell you whether or not you've answered the question, and it will show you which questions you marked for later review. You can easily go back to a specific question by highlighting it on the review screen and then clicking on that highlight with your mouse. So you don't need to work your way through all the questions in the section. Instead, you can focus on just the few that you either did not answer or that you were uncertain about. 12. Force yourself to use the breaks. In the computer-aided GRE, there's a 10-minute break partway through the exam, as well as a 1-minute break after each of the other sections. Now, you'll find that these breaks are optional. That is, if you want to plow right ahead with the next test section rather than taking the break, you can do so just by clicking the appropriate button on the test screen. But we recommend that you take the break. Use it to relax, perhaps to stretch, to take a few deep cleansing breaths, and clear your head a bit. Even 60 seconds worth of mental unwinding and relaxation can make a noticeable difference in your attitude, your anxiety, and your energy level. So take the breaks that you're permitted, and you'll find that they will refresh you and help you to do a little bit better on the next test section. 13. Consider whether to cancel before viewing your scores. At the end of the entire exam, you'll be given the option of viewing your scores on the verbal and quantitative reasoning sections immediately, or the option of canceling those scores. You can't see the analytical writing score because, as we'll discuss later, your essays have to be sent to a reader for grading, which takes a few days. By contrast, the verbal and quantitative sections can be scored immediately by the computer. Now, if you cancel your scores, neither you nor anyone else will ever see them. You have to make that decision before you actually see the scores. This option is provided as a safety valve for students who, for one reason or another, feel that they've totally blown the exam and they would just prefer that their scores be completely removed from the record. However, it does have the big disadvantage that you will never know how you really did, which reduces the value of the test experience as a learning tool. So my recommendation is that you cancel your scores only if you have a specific reason to believe that you seriously messed up the exam. For example, suppose you become physically sick during the test, or if you were so anxious that you were unable to work, or if something in your personal life was upsetting you and preventing you from concentrating, a family crisis, for instance. If one of these was the case, then go ahead and cancel and reschedule the exam for a later date when you'll be in a better frame of mind to do well. But if you simply feel that you might have done better, don't cancel your scores. You can still take the exam again, and knowing your actual scores will help you figure out which parts of the test you need the most additional practice and preparation for. Sometimes a student might feel they did terribly on the exam, and when they see their scores, they see, well, actually they did fairly well. You might think you did well on quantitative and poorly on verbal, and when you look at your scores, discover that the reverse was the case. So in most cases, looking at your score makes sense. Only cancel if you have a specific reason to believe that you really blew the exam and want to take it over again with a fresh slate. Well, this completes our overview of the entire GRE exam, and what we're going to do now is move on to the individual testing sections and provide you with some strategies and skills that will help you score your best on each part of the GRE. The analytical writing section of the GRE includes two separately timed writing tasks. First, the analyze and issue task asks you to present your perspective on some issue. Second, the analyze and argument task asks you to analyze an argument and present your evaluation of its strengths and weaknesses. Both tasks require you to write an essay, and you'll be given 30 minutes for each. The analyze an issue task presents some issue of general interest and states an opinion about it. Your job is to write an essay in which you express your own thinking about the issue. You want to take a firm position on that issue and back up your stance with reasons and examples that are relevant and clear. The analyze an argument task presents an argument about some controversy. Your job is to write an essay in which you critique the argument, explaining whether or not you find the argument to be well-reasoned and describing its strengths, its weaknesses, and its overall logical soundness. Now, the ETS website provides complete lists of the issue topics and the argument topics from which your exam questions will be drawn. The test makers call these lists pools. This means that the two topics you'll actually encounter when you take the real GRE are online for you to read right now. Unfortunately, you just won't know which ones they'll be. You should, however, spend some time reading through the topic pools. This will give you a sense of what these topics are like and will help you to begin thinking about how you're going to tackle them when you take the real exam. You might consider how you would respond to one or more of the topics that you encounter in the pools, and you can also practice by actually trying to write some 30-minute essays about selected topics from the topic pools. Chances are good that you won't be able to anticipate which particular topics actually turn up on your real exam, but simply the experience of writing an essay within the 30-minute time limit will be very good practice for tackling the real challenge when you take the actual exam. In addition, you can also find sample essays with scores and commentary by GRE test readers on the ETS website. When you can, read through those sample essays and the remarks about them, and you can get a sense of what ETS thinks makes for a high-scoring essay and how that differs from a low-scoring essay. All the topics used by ETS are designed to be ones that anyone can write about, no matter what your college major or your graduate study field. So don't be concerned if you're assigned a topic that seems to be irrelevant to what you studied in school. Chances are good that with a little bit of thought, you can come up with some interesting and worthwhile things to say about that topic, because everyone from French literature majors to physics majors is expected to tackle the same topics whenever they take the GRE. Now, the test uses very basic word processing software. Remember, you'll be doing all of your writing on the computer, just as when you write a paper using a computer for school. The basic word processing software that they provide permits inserting text simply by typing, deleting text by backspacing through it, cutting and pasting text by highlighting, hitting the cut button on the side of the screen, and then moving the cursor to where you want to paste it and hitting the paste button. And it allows you to undo whatever your previous action was by hitting the undo button. Notice that certain tools that are commonly provided in word processing software are not provided by ETS. Among the tools that are not available are spell check or grammar check. You also won't have the ability to use italics or boldface to highlight or emphasize particular words. You won't have access to automatic formatting of bulleted or numbered lists or outlines or other similar ways of organizing information. And you don't have the option to move material around simply by highlighting and then dragging and dropping it. So if you are accustomed to using any or all of these tools when you're doing writing on the computer, get used to the idea that you won't be able to do that on the GRE. You may find this ultra-simple word processing software a little frustrating, especially if you're accustomed to using more sophisticated text editors like Microsoft Word, for example. So you may want to practice writing this way between now and the day of the test. Write a sample essay or two using one of the GRE official topics every few days and restrict yourself to the basic word processing tools used on the exam, which I outlined a moment ago. And this will help you to become accustomed to the simplicity of the writing process on the GRE. Now, the two essays you write will be scored using a technique that ETS calls holistic scoring. And this works as follows. First, a teacher trained by ETS to read and grade GRE-style essays based on a set of general criteria created by the test makers will read your essay, and the teacher will give it an overall score from 0 to 6 using whole numbers only. So you could get a score of 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, or 6. There's no tallying of errors. So, for example, the reader is not supposed to go through your paper and count how many grammar mistakes you made or how many spelling errors you committed. The reader also does not assign points for separate writing criteria. So, for example, the teacher does not read your paper and then give you 2 points for clarity, 1 point for the strength of your argument, 2 points for style, or anything like that. Instead, the teacher simply reads the whole essay and gives a top-of-the-head grade reflecting his or her overall opinion of your paper. So the teacher will read the essay and say, that seems like a 4. And then she'll move on to the next paper. After the teacher has given you your score, E-Rater, which is a computer program developed by ETS, will give your essay its own score. They've developed a program for reading and evaluating student essays, which apply a number of specific criteria to determining how well written an essay is. And the program will supplement what the live human teacher has done in terms of scoring your paper. If the two scores agree, let's say the live human and the E-Rater both give you a score of 4, then the agreed upon score will be your score. If the two scores differ significantly, perhaps by more than 2, then a second human score is obtained. So let's say that the human gives your paper a score of 5, while the E-Rater gives your paper a score of 2. That's a big discrepancy. So ETS will then ask another human being to read the paper, and the final score will be the average of the two human scores. So there is a fallback position here where the E-rater's score can be overruled by a second human being. So you don't need to feel that your fate is being decided solely by a computer. If the two scores differ by only one a point, then the two scores will be averaged and that will become your final score. So if, for example, the human gives you a score of 3 and the E-rater gives you a score of 4, you'll end up with a score of 3.5. Finally, your essay will be evaluated by software that's designed to make sure that the work you're submitting is your own. So, for example, this software is designed to recognize text that is similar to that found in other GRE essays. So if, for example, you and a friend write an essay together and then submit it word for word the same when you take the same exam on the same day, the software will notice that. It will notice when you've quoted or paraphrased without attribution language that appears in some other published or unpublished source. So if you memorize a couple of paragraphs from an essay by Ralph Waldo Emerson and insert them into your essay without saying that they are from Emerson, the software should recognize that. And the software is also designed to recognize essays that are submitted as your work when in fact they've been borrowed from elsewhere or prepared by another person. Obviously, the idea here is to prevent you from memorizing and then copying an essay from another source. If you are found to have borrowed text from somewhere else, your essay won't be scored and your overall general test score will not be reported to the schools. This shouldn't be an issue so long as you're prepared to write your own original essay on the day of the exam, and we certainly strongly suggest that you apply that approach. It'll probably be no more difficult and no more hard work than actually memorizing an essay from another source would be, and you won't run the risk and the embarrassment of having your score canceled as a result of this software detecting copying. Now, what are the criteria by which your essay will be scored? In other words, when the human reader evaluates your essay, what will he or she be looking for? The key points that go to define a high-scoring essay according to the standards of ETS are as follows. First, the ideas in the essay are insightful, thoughtful, persuasive, logical, and mature. In other words, when reading your essay, a reader comes away with the impression that you've thought a bit about the topic. You've drawn intelligently upon your own experience and learning, and you've come up with some interesting, relevant things to say that make sense and offer a meaningful, thoughtful perspective on the topic. According to this criterion, a good essay will make the reader say, "Huh, that's interesting. It sounds as though a smart person wrote this." So that will be one of the things that you'll be aiming for as you write your essays. A bad essay, by contrast, would contain few or no ideas, or only ideas that are childish, silly, or nonsensical. Reading it would make a reader say, "Wow, whoever wrote this either didn't have a brain in his head or else forgot to turn it on this morning." Criterion 2. The organization of the essay is clear and coherent. This means that the essay has a logical structure, that what comes first in the essay leads naturally to what comes second. This, in turn, leads naturally to what comes third, fourth, and fifth, and all these things lead naturally to the conclusion, which, in turn, ties together the whole package in a way that is easy to follow and sensible. After reading your essay, the reader should say, "Well, I understand exactly what the writer was trying to say here, I see why she expressed it the way she did, and I grasp the logic behind all the elements she included." By contrast, after reading an essay that is bad according to this criterion, a reader might say, "I don't really understand what this writer is trying to say. There are things in here that don't seem to belong, and other things that seem to be presented in an order that makes no sense. I don't get it." You don't want to write an essay that makes a reader react like that. The third criterion. The diction and syntax of the essay are well chosen, controlled, and varied. What does this mean? Well, diction refers to word choice. Syntax refers to sentence structure. If the diction and syntax of your essay are good, this means that you've done a good job of finding the right words to express your meaning. You've chosen words that say what you want to say precisely rather than approximately or vaguely. And your vocabulary makes you sound like someone who reads books and thinks about serious issues as opposed to someone who only watches TV and plays video games. Your sentence structure should also reflect a thoughtful personality. Not all your sentences should sound exactly the same. When you have something complicated to say, you should know how to write a complicated sentence that connects three or four different ideas in a way that is easy to follow. When you have something simple to say, you should know how to write a simple sentence that states the idea clearly and forcefully. Criterion 4. The grammar, usage, and mechanics of the essay are correct. Well, this means simply that your essay doesn't contain a lot of errors in the correct use of English. It might include one or two spelling errors, but no more than that. It doesn't feature run-on sentences, sentence fragments, verbs that don't match their subject and number, a faulty parallelism, pronouns with no clear reference, or other egregious grammatical mistakes. Now, the readers who are employed by ETS, they know that you're writing quickly and that you won't have an opportunity to reread and revise your essay at leisure the way you do when you're writing a term paper, for example. And they also know that you don't have access to reference books or dictionaries. So they don't expect perfection. But if your essay is riddled with mistakes in English, that will definitely take a toll on your score. Notice that you won't be graded on the particular position you take. That is, the ideas that you express are not going to be graded as to whether they are correct or not. There is no right or wrong answer. And it's perfectly possible to write an excellent essay taking any number of positions on the topics that are assigned. What matters is how well you support your position and how clearly you write about it. Now let's take a closer look at the first of the two tasks you'll be assigned in the analytical writing section of the exam, the analyze and issue task. Here are several examples of issue topics that are similar to those in an actual ETS pool. These are the kinds of topics that could be assigned and to which you would need to react in an essay written for the analyze and issue task. Here's one. Originality does not mean thinking something that was never thought before. It means putting old ideas together in new ways. Here's another. The function of science is to reassure. The purpose of art is to upset. Therein lies the value of each. Here's another. Scandals, whether in politics, academia, or other areas, can be useful. They focus our attention on problems in ways that no speaker or reformer ever could. Yet another. The way people look, dress, and act reveals their attitudes and interests. You can tell much about a society's ideas and values by observing the appearance and behavior of its people. And one more. Many of the world's lesser-known languages are being lost as fewer and fewer people speak them. The governments of countries in which these languages are spoken should act to prevent such languages from becoming extinct. Notice what each of these issues does. It presents a general idea and a position about some topic that almost anyone could come up with an interesting and plausible position on. You might agree with the position that is stated, or you might disagree, or you might partly agree, partly disagree. Any of those would be just fine. The point is that you have to write an essay that responds or reacts to the issue in an intelligent and thoughtful way, and that presents your ideas in a way that is well written and clear. You have many options available to you in responding to the issue and the opinion presented. For example, you could strongly agree, strongly disagree, agree in part and disagree in part. You could question an underlying assumption. You could redefine or challenge one or more key terms used. You could point out the strengths or weaknesses of the opinion, or both, or you could mention and evaluate perspectives other than your own. The key, no matter which of these options you choose, is to state your perspective clearly and to organize your presentation logically and then support it with specific ideas, with examples, real or hypothetical, with stories, with quotations, with details, with facts, with logical arguments, or with personal experiences, or some combination of the above. The more supporting materials you can give, and the more relevant and interesting they are, the better your essay is likely to be, and the higher the score you're likely to enjoy. Now, we're going to present a process that will help you to score your highest on all of the essay challenges on the exam. We're going to take a closer look at the analyze and argument task a little later in this program. But first, let's talk about the overall process that we recommend whenever you have to write an essay, particularly within a short time frame, as is the case on the GRE. We call this the three-step writing process. And the three steps that we recommend you take whenever you're challenged to write an essay in a limited amount of time are pre-writing, writing, and revising. Let's go through all three and see how they would fit into the GRE scheme. Step one is pre-writing. This is a process that should take 7 to 10 minutes out of the 30 minutes that you have to write each essay on the GRE. During the pre-writing process, you'll start by reading the writing assignment, of course, and you'll decide in a general way what position you want to take in relation to the topic. Do you want to agree, disagree, partly agree or disagree, challenge an underlying assumption, or whatever? Just decide within a minute or two what position you think you want to take, what you're most comfortable with. Obviously, you're not going to have a lot of time to analyze and examine the topic. You won't have time to do any background research. You'll simply need to make a quick, somewhat arbitrary decision. Make that decision, and then go on to the next part of pre-writing, which is to brainstorm ideas for possible use in your essay. These ideas that you might include in your essay could be opinions, facts, arguments, assumptions, explanations, alternative explanations, reasons, examples, counterexamples, observations, quotations, counterarguments, objections, or any other kind of material that could be relevant to the topic that you're writing about. In a moment, we'll look at some examples of the kinds of materials that you could include in your essay and which you want to list while brainstorming. The point of the brainstorming process is to simply list as quickly as you can as many possible materials for use in the essay as you can come up with. You're then, in a later stage of the essay, going to take those materials and turn them into an actual essay. So the brainstorming process is at the heart of the pre-writing step, and you're going to spend the rest of your 7 to 10 minutes doing this brainstorming. At least that's what you'll devote most of that time to. And having done the brainstorming and listed as many random ideas as you can possibly come up with within a few moments, you're going to choose the best ideas and use those to create a simple outline for your essay. You're going to choose the 5, 7, or 10 best ideas that you think might fit nicely into the essay, select and number them in the order in which you want to use them, and then plan an essay that would run perhaps 450 to 600 words. That is, on average, 4 to 6 paragraphs. That's a reasonable amount of writing to get done within the 30 minutes constraint, and it's also enough writing so that you can develop the idea in an interesting and fairly complete way and write an essay that is likely to impress the readers. Now, for the analyze and issue task, we're going to suggest that you develop a very simple outline which would follow one of the simple basic structures that would make sense for an essay that has to be written very quickly within just about 30 minutes. There are three basic logical structures that we think work well for the analyze and issue task, and we recommend that when you practice for the exam between now and the day of the real test, that you practice writing essays using each of these three structures. The first structure looks like this. It begins with an introduction, so you'd have a paragraph in which you state in a general way what your overall position is on the topic. This would be followed by three supporting reasons, which would probably occupy 3 paragraphs or so. You could have 4 or 5 supporting reasons if you prefer. You could have 2 if each one requires a fair amount of time and space to explain. But a general good structure would be to have 3 supporting reasons. And this would then be followed by 1 more paragraph, which would provide a general conclusion, tying the whole essay together. So in this basic structure, we would have a 5-paragraph essay, a paragraph of introduction, a paragraph of conclusion, and 3 paragraphs in between, providing supporting reasons to support and defend the general position that you are taking. One basic structure that works just fine for an analyze and issue essay. Here's a second structure that you might want to consider. This also begins with an introduction, and it's followed by three pro and con arguments. That is, for this particular type of structure, the middle part of your essay would include a number of pro and con arguments, that is, arguments where you lay out and then disagree with a particular position that could be taken in regard to your structure. You could present one point of view and then show why that point of view is flawed in each of these three paragraphs in the middle part of your essay. And the whole essay would then conclude with a concluding paragraph which ties it all together and restates what your overall position is. So here we have, again, a five-paragraph essay in which the three middle paragraphs present pro and con arguments, presenting two different positions about your particular topic. And in each case, you would want to make it clear which you agree with, either the pro or the con, and why. Once again, the exact number of arguments could vary. You might want to make it four or five rather than three, but this is a good general structure to use. And a third possible structure that works well for an analyze and issue essay begins, again, with an introduction, is followed by three examples. They could be three anecdotes, stories, quotations, or illustrative examples drawn from your own experience or from reading. And this would be followed by a concluding paragraph that, again, ties it all together. So you notice each of these three structures is a way of organizing different types of material into the form of a simple essay. Each of these structures is quite simple. Remember, again, you only have 30 minutes to work with, so you don't want to create a complicated structure or one that is very sophisticated. Instead, you want to make it very simple and easy so that you can then sit down, start writing, and have time to write and revise a well-written, clear, and interesting essay. So keeping the structure simple is very important for this type of writing task. Let's consider a specific example. Suppose you need to write an essay in response to the following topic, which we saw before. Many of the world's lesser-known languages are being lost as fewer and fewer people speak them. The governments of countries in which these languages are spoken should act to prevent such languages from becoming extinct. Now, this may or may not be a good topic to you. Maybe you are a language student, or you've visited some country where a little-known language is spoken, or maybe you've seen a TV show about this topic, or then again, maybe you know very little about this topic. Whatever your particular position, your first job will be to decide what your general approach to the topic will be. And remember, even if you're not a language student or have not done any research on this topic in the past, just by using common sense and the kind of general information that most students have encountered in the course of their college years, you can probably come up with a few interesting and relevant things to say related to this topic. Now, suppose you decide, and you make a somewhat arbitrary decision, that you disagree with the position stated in the topic. That is, you think it's a bad idea for governments to try to encourage the survival of dying languages. Well, that's fine. You could take that position or a different position if you want, as long as you come up with some sensible arguments in defense of your position. Now you're ready to brainstorm. You're going to spend 3 or 4 minutes letting your mind wander around the topic and thinking of ideas that are related to the topic and which you might be able to use in your essay. As you brainstorm, you're going to write words or phrases on a piece of scrap paper to capture your ideas. This is the importance of the scrap paper that the proctor will have provided to you. The ideas don't have to be detailed. Just write a word or two or three to remind you of what the idea was. After all, the only person who needs to use these notes is you, and you're only going to be using them for the next half hour. So you don't have to worry about making your notes clear or coherent or detailed. Here are some samples of the kinds of brainstorming notes that you might come up with for this topic. Okay, you've decided that you are opposed to the position expressed in the issue, that is, that governments should support the continuance of dying languages. You've decided that you're opposed to that, but you also might decide that you're going to examine both pro and con arguments in your essay. Perhaps you will use that second structure of discussing some of the arguments in favor of preserving dying languages, but then go on to show why the con arguments against preserving the dying languages are actually better and more convincing. So you might start your brainstorming by jotting down some pro ideas. What are some of the reasons that people might want to preserve old languages? Well, one reason might be in order to retain a connection to the ancient cultures that those languages represent. There are perhaps people living in obscure parts of the world who have their own culture, which is in danger of being lost if their language dies. And we know that the modern world is becoming more and more homogeneous. There are little-known cultures in remote parts of the world that are gradually vanishing, and perhaps it would be a shame from an artistic and cultural and historic perspective to lose those obscure elements of human culture. And so one pro argument might be that preserving the language would be a way to preserve culture. So on your scrap paper, you might simply write, preserve culture. That's one pro argument. A second pro argument might be that there are some elements of things that have been written down or preserved in these dying languages that might be lost forever. For example, old stories, songs, books, or even folk wisdom that only exist in these local languages. And if the languages are forgotten, then all of those old cultural artifacts might actually be gone. So a pro argument might be to preserve these things, we need to retain some knowledge of those dying languages. So you might write down, as part of your brainstorming, the following pro argument. Old songs, stories, books, wisdom. Fine. A third pro argument might be that the groups of people who speak those dying languages might feel that it's very important in terms of their personal local pride to preserve those languages. It might make them feel important and significant in the role that they play in modern society. And so local pride might be a third pro argument. And a fourth pro argument might be that preserving the ancient culture helps us to understand the history of a particular region and a particular people, since not only works of literature, but even elements of the language might be reminders of things that happened in the long ago past, which might be lost if the language itself is lost. So understand history could be a fourth pro argument that we might jot down. And having spent a minute or two thinking of these ideas and jotting down phrases, we're ready to move on to brainstorm the con arguments. And since this is going to be the focus of our argument, we'll probably want to come up with more con arguments. Here are some of the con arguments, reasons why it's a bad idea for governments to try to preserve dying languages. One is that if you preserve the dying language of a small group, you actually help to isolate them. Let's say you have a few hundred people who speak some little-known language living in a remote mountain village somewhere. If you encourage those people to keep speaking just that language rather than learning the language of the larger culture, those people might, in a sense, be cut off from the larger society, and that might not be good for them. So one con argument might be that old languages actually isolate small groups, and we'll write that phrase on our scratch paper, isolate small groups. A second con argument might be that dying languages are very hard to revive. It's, from a practical standpoint, quite difficult to get younger people to speak a language that only a few hundred or a few thousand elderly people are speaking. After all, when television and other artifacts of the main culture are in some general, more popular language, why would young people want to learn this language that only their grandparents know? So it's very hard to maintain and revive a dying language. And is this a useful use of government resources? Not necessarily. So we can write hard to revive as a con argument. This leads to a larger point which might occur to you, and so you might simply write down not practical. Does the government really have the time, money, and resources to spend doing things like making recordings of languages, setting up schools, having books and newspapers printed in the dying language? Is this a useful use of resources? We'll write not practical as a con argument. Another argument is that language reflects society, and therefore, as society changes, it's only natural and understandable that languages should die. And the idea of trying to revive or maintain a dying language is, in a way, like saying we're going to keep society from changing, which we know, as a practical matter, is unlikely to ever really work. So this leads to a couple of other points that we could write down in the form of brief phrases on our brainstorming sheet. Language reflects society and natural process. The birth and death of languages is a natural process, and it may seem silly to try to arrest it. Another point which relates to this practicality is, are there really enough linguists available to work on all the hundreds or even thousands of dying languages that might exist around the world? Do we really have the money and the resources to find people with PhDs in linguistics and send them all around the world to work with local people on maintaining these languages? So not enough linguists might be another con argument. Should the government be in the business of setting up schools specifically to maintain a dying language? Is that a useful use of government resources? Maybe you remember reading or seeing something on television about how this has been done in Ireland and how it has caused some conflicts among people in the society as to whether this is a useful way of using government resources. Again, you may or may not remember any details, but if you have a vague sense that this might be an interesting example, you could write this down as part of your brainstorming. Set up schools, Ireland. Another con argument might be that having lots of disparate languages spoken by small groups around a country actually would separate them from society and would tend to break society up. Rather than having one language that unites everyone in a nation, if you had 6 or 8 or 10 or 15 different languages, you actually could have more difficulty getting people to work together. And so maintaining dying languages would be a way of disuniting society. So a con argument could simply be disunite society. And as you're thinking, this might make you recall a good example of how having one language can really unite a society. You might remember having learned about how India has hundreds of different local languages, and yet the language of English, which was of course imposed by the British during the centuries when they ruled India, has actually enabled the government to unite the country because English is used as the main language of government. Newspapers and the media are mostly in English, and this enables people from all over India to communicate easily together. So that's an example you might want to use in your essay. You could write India, English as unifier. Another con example that might occur to you as you're thinking through these examples, such as Ireland and India, is that tribes in places like Africa and New Guinea might be extremely small, might speak a dying language, and would be very difficult to even find, let alone to work with to maintain the language. And so an example like this might illustrate the difficulties and the impracticality of saving dying languages better than any other example. And so you might write as a con argument, tribe in Africa or New Guinea. And finally, another example that might occur to you, or another idea that might occur to you, is that people could be cut off from economy in the larger sense and from the progress that is going on in the rest of the world if they are isolated by a specific language. So your final con argument might be to write down, cut off from economy progress. Now, it took us a number of minutes to come up with these topics, and of course, that's because we had to talk about them and explain them to you as we jotted them down. In reality, if you were doing the brainstorming for the GRE, you wouldn't have to explain them to anyone. You're the only person who needs to understand them, and you could jot them down as quickly as you think of them. So, in 4 or 5 minutes, you could probably come up with 14 or 15 ideas, as we did. Of course, when you brainstorm, you'll come up with totally different ideas than I did or than someone else taking the exam would do. And that's fine because everyone's going to write a different essay. The point is just to sit down, open up your mind, and let the ideas flow. Anything that occurs to you that could be relevant to the topic, jot it down. And after a few minutes, you'll end up with 12 or 13 or 14 or 15 different words and phrases, each of which represents an idea that might fit nicely into your topic. And that's plenty to build your essay around. Now, if you were writing a term paper or a magazine article, of course you would now spend time researching the topic. You would read books and studies about it. Maybe you would interview an expert or two. You'd spend a lot of time developing your thoughts and maybe changing your point of view about the topic. But for the GRE, we don't have time for any of that. We just have a total of 30 minutes to work. So we'll stop at this point and start organizing our thoughts into the outline for our essay. Now, in this case, we've decided that we want to take the con position on the topic, but we do have a couple of interesting pro arguments to use, so why don't we use them? Let's use the B structure for our essay. We'll devote a paragraph or maybe two to pro arguments, explaining why some people might want to preserve dying languages, but then we'll devote the rest of our essay to the con arguments. We'll attach an introduction at the beginning and a conclusion at the end, and we'll have a complete essay. Now, you can create your outline very quickly and easily simply by numbering the points from your brainstorming session in the order in which you want to use them. You'll want to choose an order that makes sense and allows the arguments to flow naturally from one to the other. We'll start with the pro arguments and then shift to the cons for the following reason. It's usually best to end with the position that you agree with, since what you present as your conclusion will feel decisive. So let's go through our pro arguments and then our con arguments and number them in an order that makes sense. Starting with the pro arguments, we had jotted down in our brainstorming process four different ideas. I would say that the one about local pride is probably the least interesting and relevant, so maybe we'll leave that one out. And we'll do the other three in the following sequence. We'll start with the point about understanding history, go on to preserving culture, number two, and then the third detail we'll use will be some examples of the kinds of culture that could be preserved by supporting a dying language, old songs, stories, books, wisdom. So boom, 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 we will have gone through these three pro arguments rather briefly. We could do that in a single paragraph. And what we will do is set this up fairly early in our essay as being, here are some of the reasons why people might want to preserve dying languages, history, culture, old songs, stories, books, wisdom, but these are not really compelling arguments for the following reasons, and then we'll move on to the con arguments. So now let's look at our con arguments from our brainstorming sheet, and as you glance through these 11 items, these 11 facts or arguments or points that could be made, you might realize that there are really two groups of arguments here. One group centers on the idea that trying to preserve dying languages is not necessarily the most practical thing to do. And the second group of arguments makes the point that trying to preserve dying languages might in fact be bad for the people who use those languages. So let's group these arguments into those two subheadings, and those could be two different paragraphs or two different parts of our essay. First, let's list in sequence all the arguments that have to do with the idea that preserving dying languages may not be very practical. And then we can number them in an order that seems to make sense to present them in the essay. So we can start with not practical, go on to two, hard to revive, go on to three, set up schools with the example of Ireland if we want to use that. Fourth, language reflects society. And five, natural process. In other words, the birth and death of languages happens naturally, and it's very difficult to try to stop it and may not even really make sense. So those five facts or arguments all fit together and all relate back to the idea that this may be an idea or a proposal that is not really very practical. The rest of our items actually relate to the idea that preserving dying languages may not be good for the people who speak those languages. And we can go through those arguments or those facts in the following order. Six, it tends to isolate small groups. Seven, a tribe in Africa or New Guinea might be an example. Eight, such groups could be cut off from economy and progress. Nine, it would tend to disunite society. And 10, by contrast, look at India, we see English as a unifying language, which works better for the society as a whole than trying to maintain all the small, obscure, and dying languages that might be spoken in various parts of India. We've left out one of our arguments, the not enough linguists argument, because on reflection, we don't really know the facts, and it's not necessarily a very important or significant argument, so we can leave that out. If, in going through your brainstorming list, you decide that there are some of the items that you jotted down that, aren't really that interesting or not that relevant, or you're not quite sure what to say about them, just leave them out at this point. And even as you go on to actually writing in a few moments, you can change, add, and subtract items from your brainstorming list as you go. The point is simply to do the brainstorming and then go through all the items that you jotted down and decide roughly how they fit together naturally into a series of paragraphs. And in this case, we've got a series of pro arguments that go together. We've got two different kinds of con arguments that go together under the general heading of practicality and benefits. And these will naturally lend themselves to being in separate paragraphs. We can put them in the order that we've just numbered them. And we now have an outline that will enable us to write a decent essay. So the organization that we've come up with really coalesces around four basic ideas. We will start with the pro arguments, which we can cover in just a paragraph, then the con argument that reviving dying languages is impractical, next the con argument that even if it could be done, it would be harmful to small groups of people who speak a unique language, and finally, and closely related to the last argument, is an additional argument, which is that reviving minor languages actually could disunite society. So this is the basic structure of our argument. It's quite simple, didn't take a lot of expertise or knowledge to figure this out. If you were doing an outline for an essay on this topic, it would be totally different, and that's just fine. We're just illustrating for you one way you can do a quick and easy outline in a relatively short period of time and come up with some interesting things to include and to make the basis of an essay that could earn a high score on the exam. So, we're now all set with outlining our essay. Notice how simple a process it is. You just brainstorm for 4 to 5 minutes, jot down as many ideas as you can, and then take a step back, look at all the things you've jotted down, and figure out, okay, which of these do I want to use, and what's a logical sequence for presenting them in my essay? Number them in that order. Don't rewrite the outline. Don't bother to make a nice formal outline with ABC headings or Roman numerals or anything like that. Just work off your brainstorming list, number the items, and you're good to go. And we are now, having worked our way through the entire pre-writing process, we're ready to begin step two of the process, which is the actual writing. Step two, the actual writing process, should take you between 10 and 15 minutes when you're working on the GRE. The idea here is to get your ideas down on the computer screen as quickly as possible. Follow your outline and just flesh out the points one by one in the sequence in which you organize them. This might involve writing a couple of sentences about each of the points that you listed, or it might involve simply rewriting your note and moving on to the next point if your note in itself said all that needed to be said. If you're stymied for an opening, start with the second paragraph, or simply ask yourself, what exactly am I trying to say? Summarize your overall position on the issue in one sentence and make that your opening. If you draw a blank on a name, word, or some other detail, there's something you want to mention and you can't quite remember how to describe it, just skip it and come back to it. You can probably remember it later in the writing process and you can always go back and fill it in later. If the missing name, word, or other detail doesn't come to you, then paraphrase, talk your way around it, and explain the point you're trying to make. Again, the readers understand you only have limited time and no access to research materials, and they won't penalize you for the fact that you don't remember the exact word. Above all, don't agonize over the right word to the point where you lose writing momentum. You will be revising your essay in a few minutes, and you'll have a chance to add better details and more information later if you think of it. The important thing is to get all of your material down on the computer screen as quickly as you can so that you'll end up with an essay which you can then revise and improve and make it even better. The important thing is to get the thing written in this 10 to 15 minute process, and then you'll be able to revise it and make it sound better in the third and final stage of the writing process. As you write, use the following tricks to sound smart. These are techniques that experienced and professional writers use in order to make what they write sound intelligent and thoughtful. And remember, that's one of the key criteria on which your essay will be judged by ETS's readers. They want to get the feeling that you've thought about the topic and have something interesting and mature to say about it. So to sound smart is one of the most important skills to develop and practice between now and the day of the exam. And here are some specific writing techniques that will help you to sound smart. First, refer to the topic. mention the topic you're discussing and, if possible, quote from it, using quotation marks to enclose the words that you're repeating from the actual topic. This will show that you understand the assignment and are carrying it out according to instructions rather than just writing about what you feel like. So referring to the topic actually shows that you're on point and that you're responding appropriately to the assignment given to you by the GRE test makers. Second, spill the beans. By which we mean state your main idea early in the essay and go out of your way to show throughout the paper how each idea relates to the main idea. So if, for example, in this particular essay, your position is that trying to preserve dying languages is a bad idea for society and even for the users of those languages, say that in so many words early in the essay. And then, wherever it's appropriate throughout the essay, refer back to your main idea. Say, another reason why trying to preserve dying languages is a bad idea is that, blah, blah, blah. By spilling the beans early and often in the essay, you make it easy for the reader to follow your main point, and you make it clear that you understand exactly what you're trying to say, and that the whole essay ties together around that main idea. So be clear, forceful, and direct in stating your main idea. The reader shouldn't have to guess what it is. It's surprising how often students write essays, and then when they read the essay back at the end, they realize they never did state their main idea. So be sure to state it early and often in your essay. Third, back up all your ideas with evidence. Don't just state ideas as if the reader should accept them simply on your say-so. Try to offer supporting evidence to back up each idea. And that evidence could be of many kinds. It could be a fact, a story, an example, an argument, a detail, a quotation, anything that you can come up with that will help convince the reader that what you say is true, or at least that you have good reason to say it. And this is where your brainstorming, of course, will be important. If you did a good job of brainstorming, then you jotted down 10 or 12 or 15 different facts or pieces of evidence that could be used somewhere in the essay. And you may think of more as you work your way through the actual writing process. Whenever you think of a good example, illustration, fact, or detail that helps to support your argument, throw it into the essay. It will show your reader that you have thought through the topic and that you understand that your position can't be simply stated and let go at that. It needs to be supported with some evidence, and that's the reason for using those details. Fourth, be judicious and make necessary concessions. What this means is that you want to present your point of view not in a black and white, all-encompassing way as if your position is correct and any other possible position is totally wrong and stupid. Instead, when you're disagreeing with another point of view, it's good to mention the parts of the opposing viewpoint that you actually agree with or accept. In the particular essay that we're working on now, we talked about including the pro arguments, and you might want to say in your essay that the pro arguments have some validity. However, the con arguments outweigh them for the following reasons. So it's quite good in an essay to have a sentence or two where you say something to the effect of the following. It is true that A, B, and C. However, I disagree for the following reasons, D, E, and F. And this makes you sound balanced, thoughtful, and fair-minded. So, in a sense, presenting the opposing point of view in a fair way actually helps to make you sound smart and as though you've approached the topic in a thoughtful, balanced fashion. Fifth, be specific. Whenever possible, climb down the abstraction ladder. And here's what we mean by that. The higher rungs on the abstraction ladder involve ideas that are more abstract and general, while the lower rungs are more specific, narrow, and concrete. And an essay that consists entirely of broad, abstract statements tends to sound vague and rather empty, whereas one that includes specific, concrete details like names, events, dates, numbers, quotations, and other hard facts tends to sound clear and accurate. So whenever you can think of a specific fact, detail, name, or event that ties in with your topic and that helps to support your argument, put that into the essay. It makes your essay sound much more convincing, much more thoughtful, and makes you sound smarter. So climb down that abstraction ladder as much as you can. Sixth, use the paragraph as your structural unit. Each paragraph of your essay should contain one main idea, and when you're ready to move on to the next idea, start a new paragraph. So if you have six paragraphs in your essay, they should represent six separate ideas, six building blocks in the overall logical structure of your presentation. If you find yourself writing a paragraph and it runs very, very long, 10, 12, 13 sentences, stop and say, wait a minute, haven't I drifted from one idea to the next? If so, look for a place in the middle of the paragraph where you can break it into two, because chances are good you're really presenting more than one main idea and squeezing them both into the same paragraph. By the same token, if you write a number of paragraphs that are only one or two sentences long, you probably are not developing the ideas in enough depth. So make each paragraph the presentation of one main idea, develop that idea in enough detail, and then move on to the next idea and to another paragraph, so that as the reader moves from paragraph to paragraph, he or she will feel as though they're moving through the logical steps in an argument that is clearly presented and broken down into a logical sequence. That's the whole point of using paragraphs in your essay. 7, use signpost words. These are words or phrases that serve to guide the reader and connect one idea to the next. So, for example, use words like first, second, or next to connect one idea to the next. Use words or phrases like similarly, by contrast, for example, therefore, as this shows, which suggests the relationship between one part of the essay and the next part of the essay. Whenever you use signpost words and phrases like these, you are sending a signal to the reader. The detail that I'm about to mention plays the following role in the essay. It serves as an example, or it shows a difference between what I was just talking about and what I'm now talking about. And so you could use a signpost phrase like, by contrast, or on the other hand. Or if you want to follow through a sequence of events in which one event leads to the next, you might want to use a signpost phrase like, therefore, or as a result, or consequently. So those signpost words, which might be easy to overlook, actually play a very important role in helping to organize your ideas. And as you move from one paragraph to the next, look for an opportunity to begin the paragraph or early in the paragraph to include a signpost word or a signpost phrase that signals clearly to the reader what role the next paragraph is going to play in your essay. 8. Emphasize the connections among related ideas. So when two or more ideas play a similar role in your essay and are comparable to one another, or perhaps have a cause and effect relationship with one another, then point this out. And you could use signpost phrases like, in the same way, or another example is, or the next important reason is, or based on this fact, we can also conclude that. You see the role that signpost phrases like these play? This will show the reader that you've thought about and understand the connections among your ideas, and you're explaining them clearly, so it's easy for the reader to follow. When you do this for the reader says, huh, this person's mind is really working clearly, and this is a smart person who deserves a high score on the essay. And 9, vary sentence length. This means that you should avoid writing a lot of sentences that are all about the same number of words. When all your sentences are roughly the same length, it makes your writing sound monotonous and boring. So, from time to time, use a short sentence for emphasis. After a series of long sentences, say 20 words or more, a short sentence of 10 words or less breaks up the rhythm and gives the reader a bit of a pleasant jolt. And such a short sentence is a good place to state an important idea, since the reader will notice it and probably remember it. And 10, emphasize key ideas by location. The beginning and ending of any unit of writing is the most emphatic location, the part that your reader will notice the most and remember the most. So the most interesting, important, and persuasive ideas should come near the beginning or near the end of your essay. You can also use the first and last sentence of a paragraph to state an idea that's interesting and important, since your reader will be more likely to notice it there. By contrast, ideas that are buried in the middle of your essay or in the middle of a paragraph will get less attention and are more likely to be overlooked or forgotten. So use the beginning or the ending for the points that deserve the greatest emphasis. Using all of these principles, which will help you to sound smart, we've written an example of the kind of essay you could write for the GRE based on the topic that we chose and the outline that we created before. Pause this program and read through this essay in your study guide. After you've read it, return to this program and I'll point out a few of its key features. First, notice how clear and logical the structure of the essay is. It begins with an introductory paragraph that describes the topic and talks about the idea of preserving dying languages, and also states clearly the main idea that the author wants to present. But while the impulse behind this idea is understandable and even admirable, in the end it is a flawed and impractical concept. So the opening paragraph of this essay clearly states the main idea. It spills the beans, which is an important part of sounding smart. The essay also ends with a paragraph that restates the main idea and sums up the whole essay nicely. So as a result, it all feels tied together logically, and there's no way that you can be in doubt as to the author's position on the topic. Now, the internal structure of the essay, those middle paragraphs, is also quite clear. The second paragraph is devoted to the pro arguments. It begins, "From the point of view of a scholar, the reasons for trying to preserve little used languages are clear." And then the paragraph goes on to list those reasons. Then the third paragraph, which is quite short, is used to clearly shift from the pro arguments to the con arguments. It says, "But do these arguments show that governments should adopt policies and programs to preserve little-used languages? There are strong reasons to conclude that the answer is no." Notice how well that paragraph sets up the whole rest of the essay. And paragraphs 4, 5, and 6 each present one of the main con arguments. It's always easy to tell where you are in the discussion and exactly how the parts of the essay fit together. Notice, too, that the paragraph is used as the main structural element of the essay. Each paragraph performs a distinct function, and signpost words are used to help guide the reader from one step of the argument to the next. So, for example, the third paragraph begins with the word "but," which clearly signals that a change in the direction of the discussion is coming. And the fourth, fifth, and sixth paragraphs begin with the words "first," "second," and finally, so that readers can easily see that the three main con arguments are being presented here, 1, 2, and 3. You might think that this device could make the essay sound formulaic or boring, but actually it doesn't. It makes the essay seem very clear, well thought out, and easy to understand. Remember, your test grader will be reading your essay along with dozens of others. He or she will spend only a few minutes on it. The grader is likely to be relieved, pleased, and impressed to discover that you've written an essay that doesn't require a struggle to be understood. The end result should be a good grade. The essay also uses specific concrete examples. It does not remain high on the abstraction ladder, but instead goes down the abstraction ladder to give specific details. So, for example, we have the reference to, quote, "old songs, stories, myths, legends, and proverbs" in the second paragraph. We have in paragraph 4 the discussion of the schools established in Ireland to maintain the old Irish language. And we have the references to tribes in Africa and New Guinea in paragraph 5, and the use of the example of India in paragraph 6. These specific details make the argument sound much more convincing, and they also make the essay much more interesting to read. Finally, also notice how sentences of varied lengths are used. A few sentences which describe complex connections among ideas are fairly long. For example, we have the paragraph that reads, "Because these cultural artifacts may never have been written down or translated into other languages, they are in danger of disappearing forever once the few remaining speakers of the language in which they are preserved die out." But these long sentences are interspersed with shorter ones, which are used to state main ideas, or to orient the reader, or to vary the rhythm of the essay, which makes it more pleasant to read. So notice, for example, how the start of the fourth paragraph contains two short sentences followed by a long one. First, there is the question of practicality, period. "Preserving a dying language by artificial means is extremely difficult, period." and then the long sentence. When few people want to use a particular language and the great majority of those living in a certain place prefer to use a different tongue, how can they be forced to choose the language they view as old-fashioned, limited, or inaccessible? So the variation between short and long sentences makes the whole section a little more interesting and enjoyable to read, and it works much better than if all the sentences were similar in length. So for all these reasons that we've analyzed, this would be considered an excellent essay, and it would probably earn a score of 6 from most readers. Okay, this completes the second step in the 3-step writing process, writing. We'll talk about step 3, rewriting, in a moment, but first, let's take a little detour to talk about the other type of essay you'll have to write for the analytical writing section of the GRE, the analyze and argument task. For this part of the exam, you'll read an argument, that is, a presentation of someone else's opinion or judgment about an issue, along with evidence or information to support that opinion. Then you'll be asked to respond to the argument, evaluating whether or not it's logical, well-reasoned, and convincing. Your job is not just to write a good essay in response to the argument, but also to analyze the argument and offer a thoughtful critique of its strengths and weaknesses. Now, to evaluate the argument, you'll need to consider 4 crucial elements: the nature of the evidence presented, the unstated assumptions being made, the implications of what is stated, and the logical connections among the points made. Your job is not to present your own opinion about the issue, but rather to evaluate the strength or weakness of the argument presented. To have a better sense of what we're talking about, here are several examples of argument topics from an actual ETS pool. Here's the first one. Milk and dairy products are rich in vitamin D and calcium, substances essential for building and maintaining bones. Many people therefore say that a diet rich in dairy products can help prevent osteoporosis, a disease that is linked to both environmental and genetic factors and that causes the bones to weaken significantly with age. But a long-term study of a large number of people found that those who consistently consume dairy products throughout the years of the study have a higher rate of bone fractures than any other participants in the study. Since bone fractures are symptomatic of osteoporosis, this study result shows that a diet rich in dairy products may actually increase rather than decrease the risk of osteoporosis. Here's a second example. The following appeared in a letter to the school board in the town of Centerville. All students should be required to take the driver's education course at Centerville High School. In the past 2 years, several accidents in and around Centerville have involved teenage drivers. Since a number of parents in Centerville have complained that they are too busy to teach their teenagers to drive, some other instruction is necessary to ensure that these teenagers are safe drivers. Although there are 2 driving schools in Centerville, parents on a tight budget cannot afford to pay for driving instruction. Therefore, an effective and mandatory program sponsored by the high school is the only solution to this serious problem. Here's a third example. 2 years ago, radio station WCQP in Rockville decided to increase the number of call-in advice programs that it broadcasts. Since that time, its share of the radio audience in the Rockville listening area has increased significantly. Given WCQP's recent success with call-in advice programming and citing a nationwide survey indicating that many radio listeners are quite interested in such programs, the station manager of KICK in Midway recommends that KICK include more call-in advice programs in an attempt to gain a larger audience share in its listening area. Another example. Woven baskets characterized by a particular distinctive pattern have previously been found only in the immediate vicinity of the prehistoric village of Pelea, and therefore were believed to have been made only by the Pelean people. Recently, however, archaeologists discovered such a Pelean basket in Lithos, an ancient village across the Brim River from Pelea. The Brim River is very deep and broad, and so the ancient Peleans could have crossed it only by boat, and no Pelean boats have been found. Thus it follows that the so-called Pelean baskets were not uniquely Pelean. And a final example. The following appeared in a memo from the owner of a chain of cheese stores located throughout the United States. For many years, all the stores in our chain have stocked a wide variety of both domestic and imported cheeses. Last year, however, all of the 5 best-selling cheeses at our newest store were domestic cheddar cheeses from Wisconsin. Furthermore, a recent survey by Cheeses of the World magazine indicates an increasing preference for domestic cheeses among its subscribers. Since our company can reduce expenses by limiting inventory, the best way to improve profits in all of our stores is to discontinue stocking many of our varieties of imported cheese and concentrate primarily on domestic cheeses. Okay, these are the kinds of arguments that you have to analyze for this part of the GRE. How do you go about doing that? Well, the analyze and argument task calls for some special skills. These begin with the ability to analyze the argument in the first place. A good way to start is knowing how to recognize the major parts of any argument. These are the conclusion, the evidence, and the hidden assumptions. First, the conclusion. The conclusion may come first, last, or in the middle. The conclusion is what the argument is trying to prove. Look for words like therefore, thus, we may conclude that, it is obvious that, as you can see, etc. These often indicate when the author is about to state the conclusion. So look for the conclusion first when analyzing any argument. Next, look for the evidence. The evidence is anything and everything that is used to support the argument, anything that the author mentions in an attempt to convince you that the conclusion is correct. The evidence may include examples, statistics, anecdotes, quotations from experts, eyewitness testimony, statements of cause and effect, analogies or comparisons, and emotional appeals. Any or all of these could be used in an argument in an attempt to get you to agree with the conclusion. Some of these may be valid and may support the argument strongly, others may not be, and that'll be part of what you need to analyze as you analyze the argument. And the third key element is the hidden assumptions. The hidden assumptions are not stated in the passage. They are conditions that must be true if the conclusion is to be true. Some hidden assumptions are plausible and likely. Others are dubious, and it's a matter of judgment to decide whether a particular hidden assumption is plausible and likely, or whether it may be dubious and unlikely to be true. Here's a simple example. Suppose I said the following. I forgot to bring my umbrella to work today, and it just started raining. I guess I'll have to get wet. Well, this is a very short little statement, and yet it takes the form of an argument. In this case, I'm making the conclusion that I'm going to get wet when I leave work today. The evidence is the other part of the statement. I forgot to bring my umbrella to work today, and it just started raining. Two different facts. Based on those two pieces of evidence, I have reached the conclusion that I guess I'll have to get wet. Is this argument valid? Well, one way to analyze the validity of this argument is by taking apart the hidden assumptions. The hidden assumptions, which are not stated in my argument, but which must be true if my conclusion is to be true, include the following. One, it will keep on raining. Suppose it has just started raining and it's the early morning and it's going to stop raining in the next 10 minutes. Then it won't be true that I will get wet when I leave work. Another hidden assumption, I can't buy or borrow an umbrella. Maybe there's an umbrella that I could borrow from someone else in the office, or maybe there's a shop in the lobby of the office building where I work where umbrellas along with other items are sold, in which case I wouldn't have to get wet. So the hidden assumption that I can't buy or borrow an umbrella may or may not be true. And a third hidden assumption, I will leave work sometime today. Suppose I had turned up at the fire station and I was going to be there for the next 3 days, then I wouldn't get wet later today because I probably wouldn't have to leave the fire station. It's highly unlikely that I'm going to be in my workplace for the next several days. It is highly likely to be true that I will leave work sometime today, but it's important to recognize that that is, in fact, one of the hidden assumptions of the argument, that I will leave work sometime today. It must be true if my conclusion is going to be true, that the rain that's falling outside is going to make me wet when I leave work. Notice that if an argument is to be valid, the assumptions must be plausible, and in addition, the evidence must logically support the conclusion. If evidence is thrown out in an argument which has nothing to do with the conclusion, then that weakens the argument. And in the same way, if there are hidden assumptions underlying the argument which are implausible or unlikely to be true, the argument will collapse. If the assumptions are false or dubious, or the evidence doesn't logically support the conclusion, then the argument falls down. Now, Many arguments presented in the analytical writing section of the GRE will contain one or more logical flaws or weaknesses, which are sometimes referred to as fallacies. And when you write your essay in the analyze and argument portion of the GRE, your job will be to point out any such flaws or weaknesses and to explain why they damage the argument. So it's very useful to know some of the most common types of fallacies. And in the next few minutes, we will look at that, some very common types of fallacies that appear in arguments all the time, both on the GRE and in the real world, and will help you to recognize these fallacies so that if they do crop up on the exam, you'll recognize them and be able to point them out in your essay. One very common type of fallacy is insufficient evidence. In this case, we have an argument that contains evidence that doesn't suffice to support the conclusion. The evidence is either irrelevant or too small or not a very good illustration to support the broad conclusion that is being drawn. Examples of insufficient evidence might include a survey with a sample that is too small or not representative of the complete population, or a conclusion that's based on one or two examples that may not illustrate any broader trend. Insufficient evidence is probably the most common type of logical weakness. When you read the newspaper, watch TV, you'll encounter insufficient evidence all the time. Here's a famous example from history to illustrate the nature of insufficient evidence. Literary Digest magazine used to conduct straw polls that were very successful at predicting the outcomes of presidential campaigns. They used millions of mock ballots that were sent out to their readers and to others. And based on the results of that mock balloting, Literary Digest would predict the winner of the presidential election. Now, in the year 1936, the results that poured in during the months leading up to the election showed there would be a landslide victory for Republican Alf Landon in that year's election. But Franklin D. Roosevelt was reelected by a huge margin, an even bigger margin than he carried in 1932. The Digest's experience in 1936 proved that even if a sample is massive, it could produce unreliable results if the methodology is flawed. In this case, the mailing lists that the editors of Literary Digest used came from directories of telephone subscribers and automobile owners. And back in 1936, those two groups were prosperous groups, which included mostly people who favored the Republicans, especially during the Great Depression. And so Literary Digest's poll, even though it was based on a survey of millions of people, was badly flawed and didn't represent the average voter. And that's why their conclusion was so badly flawed as well. In this case, the evidence, though massive, was insufficient. It's a good example of how insufficient evidence can jump up and bite you, even in a seemingly well-constructed argument. A second common type of fallacy is known by the Latin name of post hoc ergo propter hoc, which means in Latin, after this, therefore, because of this. We have this fallacy whenever we assume that the fact that A is followed by B means that A caused B. In real life, cause and effect relationships often are not obvious. Sometimes A and B, which happen together, are both caused by some third thing, rather than A simply causing B. Sometimes there's really no connection between A and B other than a coincidental one. Remember the topic that we read a moment ago about calcium and osteoporosis? This is an example of post hoc ergo propter hoc thinking. The fallacy built into that argument is based on a faulty cause and effect relationship, or a possibly faulty cause and effect relationship between dairy products and osteoporosis. It's quite possible that the higher rates of bone fractures observed in the study could have been caused by some other factor than higher consumption of calcium. For example, perhaps the study subjects who consumed more calcium led a more active lifestyle, which in turn could have resulted in a larger number of sports injuries and broken bones. Here's a real-life example of the post hoc ergo propter hoc fallacy. A certain politician charged that welfare actually causes child poverty, and the politician cited a study by two Ohio State University sociologists showing that the highest increases in the rate of child poverty occurred in states that paid the highest welfare benefits. So the politician said, you see, this proves that the welfare benefits cause poverty. However, the study overlooked the fact that median income declined or was flat in the 10 states where both welfare payments and child poverty rose, while income rose substantially in 9 of the 10 states where welfare payments and poverty showed the least increase. What really was happening was that economic decline was causing an increase in both welfare and child poverty. So the politician was confused and was mistakenly drawing a cause and effect relationship between two things that in fact were caused by some third thing. A good example of the post hoc ergo propter hoc fallacy. Here's another common fallacy, the straw man. This involves presenting a version of an opposing argument that is exaggerated, inaccurate, and weak, and then refuting that. In other words, it's taking an opposing point of view and presenting it in a caricatured, incomplete way and arguing against that, rather than actually dealing with the strong arguments that an opponent might present. Here's an example of the straw man fallacy. Since the rise of the internet, there has been an ongoing debate between cultural critics who like the openness and freedom of the internet and those who dislike it because they feel that allowing everyone to write and publish without controls weakens the idea of high artistic standards. Now, in a recent book, one critic who likes the freedoms of the internet wrote, "Internet curmudgeons argue that Google et al. Are bringing society to ruin precisely because they rob the so-called creative class of its financial support and exclusivity, its pedestal." This quotation from the book is a straw man argument because it takes the argument of the internet critics and makes it sound completely self-serving and elitist. It's an unfair oversimplification of what is, in fact, a somewhat complicated debate. As you can probably tell, straw man arguments are very common in political debates, where very often a politician running against an opponent will present an unfair or distorted picture of the opponent's position as a way of gaining votes. If you encounter a straw man argument on the GRE, you would want to point out the fact that this is a fallacy and is not a fair or accurate way to argue. And another common fallacy is circular reasoning. This is when you fail to give any real evidence, but instead merely restate the conclusion. This sounds as though it might be obvious, but in fact, the way it's normally done in real life and the way it would be done on a GRE would be rather subtle and therefore not always easy to recognize. For example, suppose an argument were to state the following. Lower taxes are economically desirable because they allow a greater percentage of the national income to be retained by the private sector as opposed to the government. Okay, now this may sound plausible, but think about what this is stating. By definition, money that isn't taxed is retained by the private sector rather than the public sector. So if you think about what this argument is saying, it's really just saying, in effect, it's better to tax less because it's better to tax less. This is a classic case of circular reasoning. The way it's written makes it sound as though there's more substance to it than that, but in effect, the author is simply restating a basic conclusion and using this as evidence. And of course, that doesn't work as evidence at all. It's circular reasoning and logically fallacious. Here's another common fallacy, the excluded middle, also known as black and white reasoning. In an excluded middle argument, it's assumed that things can be sorted into only two clearly opposed and mutually exclusive categories, whereas in reality, we all know there are many shades of gray in the world. Things are not necessarily black and white. For example, think back to the GRE argument about radio stations WCQP and KICK. The person writing that argument assumes that since WCQP increased its audience after adding more call-in advice programs, KICK can increase its audience by doing the same. But think about it. Are the two options presented, more call-in advice programs versus fewer, are these two options clearly opposed and mutually exclusive? Is it so easy to define radio programming as more call-in advice programs versus fewer? Don't many other factors need to be considered? For example, what kind of call-in shows? Are they all equivalent? Is a political discussion program the same as a raucous relationship advice show? Would a program about diagnosing car problems be the same as one that offers stock picks? Obviously not. The argument presents as a black and white choice what is really a series of more complex decisions. So whenever you read an argument on the GRE or elsewhere that presents an issue as if there are simply two mutually exclusive, very clear choices and nothing else, chances are good that excluded middle fallacy is rearing its head. And another common fallacy, ambiguous terminology. In this fallacy, an argument is based on a term that is vague or unclearly defined. An example would be the term family values, which is used in cultural and political contexts in a number of ways. It can be taken to mean, for example, respect for others, hard work, self-reliance, but at times it can be used to mean prejudice against those who have different religious or ethical beliefs or sexual preference. Here's another example. Jones is from New York, and most New Yorkers are liberal, so Jones is probably liberal. But think about this argument for a moment. What if Jones lives in upstate New York rather than New York City? In upstate New York, most people are conservative. So notice there's a subtle form of ambiguous terminology in this argument. The term New York or New Yorker is being used as if it has one clear meaning. Whereas, in fact, there are many different kinds of New Yorkers. The term New York may have more than one meaning, and those different meanings have different implications. And one more common type of fallacy is the false analogy. Here, a similarity between two things or two situations is assumed when that similarity may not be valid or relevant. For example, consider this argument. The proposed government program might perform some useful functions, but it would cost much more money than it would produce. Therefore, the proposed program must be rejected because government, like business, must be operated with sensitivity to the bottom line. Well, this argument sounds convincing, but think about the analogy between government and business. Are the purposes, structure, and roles of government and business really the same? Should they be? It's an important issue, and there could be positions taken on both sides, but the argument assumes that the answer is obvious, that of course government and business are basically the same, and that's misleading at best. So a false analogy is one in which a similarity between two things is assumed to be true, where that similarity may or may not really be there. In a more honest and complete argument, you would address that similarity and provide evidence to prove that the similarity is a valid one. Now, this is just a sampling of some of the most common kinds of fallacies. You want to practice being sensitive to these fallacies whenever you read, watch TV, look at advertisements, listen to political discussions, or study arguments in any other context. The better you are at spotting fallacies and recognizing their logical flaws, the easier it will be for you to come up with cogent analyses of the arguments that appear on the GRE. Let's use the expertise you've just gained in analyzing arguments to tackle one of the sample GRE topics we read before. Take a look again at the following argument, which we saw previously, and in a moment we'll start by identifying the conclusion, the evidence, and the hidden assumptions. Okay, what's the conclusion in this argument? That is, what is the point that the argument is trying to convince you about? It happens to appear in the final sentence of the argument. The best way to improve profits in all of our stores is to discontinue stocking many of our varieties of imported cheese and concentrate primarily on domestic cheeses. Okay, that's the conclusion. What is the evidence? Basically, it's everything else that appears in the argument. But let's lay out the specific points that the argument seems to be leaning on, the facts or ideas that the president of the cheese company believes support his conclusion. These pieces of evidence are as follows. First, last year, the five best-selling cheeses at our newest store were all domestic cheddar cheeses from Wisconsin. Second, a recent survey by Cheeses of the World magazine indicates an increasing preference for domestic cheeses among its subscribers. And third, our company can reduce expenses by limiting inventory. The first two pieces of evidence here are being used to suggest that the customers of the cheese company mainly want to buy domestic rather than foreign cheese. And based on this, the president of the company believes that profits will increase if the company focuses mainly on domestic cheeses. The third piece of evidence may have slipped by you since it's mentioned almost in passing in the final sentence on the way to the conclusion, but it's an important bit of logic. The company can reduce expenses by limiting inventory, that is, by buying fewer kinds of cheese to keep in its warehouses or its stores. This is supposed to support the conclusion that profits can be increased by reducing the number of foreign cheeses stocked, because, as you know, when the costs of a business go down and sales revenues either remain the same or increase, then profits, by definition, increase. Now the tricky part. What are the hidden assumptions, the ideas that must be true if the argument is to hold water? One good way to find them is by looking at the evidence and the conclusion and examining the connection between them, or the lack of a connection. Very often, a hidden assumption describes the missing or unstated connection, which must be accurate if the evidence really supports the conclusion. With that in mind, let's look again at our evidence and see if we can figure out what hidden assumptions are needed to make them support the conclusion. Here again is the first piece of evidence. Last year, the 5 best-selling cheeses at our newest store were all domestic cheddar cheeses from Wisconsin. Now, if this is going to support the conclusion, which, remember, is that eliminating most foreign cheeses will increase profits, then a few hidden assumptions must be true. One is that the sales pattern at the company's newest store also applies to the company's other sales outlets. Notice what a narrow piece of evidence the president is relying on, sales from a single store. What if that store is not representative of all the other stores in the chain? What if that store is in a town where cheddar cheese is all the rage, while many of the other stores are in towns where Brie or Munster or Manchego cheese are popular? If that's the case, then this piece of evidence would not support the conclusion. Another hidden assumption here is that last year's sales patterns will continue into the future. Maybe last year was an aberration. There was a big cheddar cheese craze after Will Smith appeared as the cheddar cheese goblin in the latest Batman movie. If cheese lovers switch to foreign cheeses next year, then this piece of evidence will go down the tubes. And here's another, more subtle, hidden assumption. The president is assuming that the store's overall sales volumes are affected mainly or entirely by the 5 best-selling cheeses. That is, so long as you stock plenty of the 5 bestsellers, it doesn't matter too much what else you carry. Now, this could be false in a couple of ways. For example, it could be that the sales of the 5 bestsellers only total, say, 30% of the company's sales. It might be that the sales of the next 20 most popular cheeses together make up another 40% of the company's sales, and maybe 18 of those 20 cheeses might be foreign cheeses. If that's the case, then getting rid of most foreign cheeses could have a devastating effect on overall sales. Another problem could be as follows. Maybe a significant number of customers visit the cheese store to look at, sample, and buy small portions of the exotic cheeses from around the world. Even though these cheeses don't make up a huge bulk of the company's sales, they might play an important role in attracting visitors to the stores. It might be that if the foreign cheeses were eliminated and the store had displays showing nothing but different kinds of U.S. cheddar, customers might quickly become bored and simply stop visiting. So you see then that it's not necessarily true that the overall sales volume of the stores is mainly dependent on the top 5 best-selling cheeses. This is a hidden assumption that may or may not be correct, and if it's wrong, it could drastically weaken the argument. Now, there are similar hidden assumptions and hidden weaknesses behind the other pieces of evidence offered in the argument, which I'll let you discover for yourself. In writing your analysis of the argument, you need to point out weaknesses like these. The basic fallacy in this argument is insufficient evidence. The president of the cheese store chain is basing his conclusion on a couple of slender reads, a sliver of sales data from a single store, and a survey of magazine readers who may or may not represent the company's actual customer base. Your essay